Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Grace and peace to all of you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship here on this, the day we celebrate the feast of our Lord's ascension into heaven. And this is our prayer for the day. Almighty God, whose blessed Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, ascended far above all heavens that he might fill all things, mercifully give us faith to perceive that according to his promise, he abides with his church on earth, even to the end of the ages. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. On this feast of the Ascension, let's join in singing, He is Exalted, a song we've done in worship a few times, and there the lyrics are there in your little insert. Exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. The Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. And that's what we reflect on today, that the same Jesus who walked the earth, died for our sins, rose from the dead in his glorified body, ascended in that body to the heavens and reigns at the right hand of God right now and will return someday at the end of all things. We live in this hope, but until then, we continue to rest in God as our source of strength and comfort and during these times, now perhaps more than any time we can remember in our life, we rely on God's grace and the strength of his promises and his steadfast love. So let us join in Psalm 138, one of many psalms that reminds us of the steadfast love of God. Let's join together. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart, and before the gods I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. On the day I called, you answered me. The strength of my soul you increased. All the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. And they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, as I mentioned, our worship today is focused on the great event of Christ's ascension into heaven. All four Gospels attest to this event, but the most specific account is given through the writer Luke, who in his two books, Luke and Acts, ends the Gospel with the ascension and begins the book of Acts with the ascension. And so I'm going to sort of splice those together into one sort of continuous reading, beginning with Luke 24, 44 to 48, and then just jumping right to the first chapter of Acts and continuing the narrative. So listen for the account that we have from the St. Luke, the evangelist. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." And so they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, even to the ends of the earth." And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, as I mentioned, that we have the two-part account given by Luke. He begins this book of Acts saying how in the former account, in the first book, which we call the Gospel of Luke, he talked about everything Jesus did while he walked among us on earth until he was taken up into heaven. And now in the second part, I'm going to continue to talk about what he did after his physical body was taken up into heaven. And this moment then of Jesus being in his body, moving from earth back to heaven, is obviously an astonishing turning point in his whole mission of salvation, is his work of redemption. And from here on, he will reign over his church from heaven in the power of the Holy Spirit through what is called his mystical body, the church. Now, of course, the significance of this is profound beyond words. I mean, it's not only a turning point in Christ's work, it's a turning point in history. It's a turning point of reality itself when the man from heaven came, God came from heaven and now returns to heaven as a man in a male body. So they needed to understand the significance of this event. And so it's small wonder that Jesus spent this intervening 40 days from his resurrection to this moment of his return to heaven doing two things. First, in 1:3, Luke tells us, he presented himself alive to them after his sufferings with many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days. That is, he again and again and again demonstrated physically, evidentially, empirically, that he was Jesus, the man that they knew, risen from the dead, that this is who he is, right? Again and again. Give me something to eat. Let me touch my hands. Put your fingers in my wounds. He did anything he had to do, so they knew that it was him. The other thing he did, as Luke tells us, is that he opened their minds to the scriptures and helped them understand that everything written about him in the law and the prophets and the Psalms, the three great divisions of the Jewish Bible, everything written about him had to be fulfilled, that he had to suffer and rise from the dead in order to achieve the redemption of human beings. He opened their minds to preach the kingdom of God, which was going to be their commission. They had to be fully convinced witnesses to the truth of this, to him and his resurrection and his ascension. And they were. They were. By the time he left, they had no doubt who he was and what he had done. But they were still a little confused as to what it all meant and how it all worked. In Acts 1:6, the first thing they say is, so Lord, then does this mean now you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Now, this is not a stupid question. It's perfectly reasonable. As Jews, they naturally assumed that as he constantly talked about the kingdom of God, he meant David's kingdom. They assumed he meant the kingdom of Israel. All through the Jewish scriptures, there's promises of the restoration of the one who would come to restore the kingdom of David. They were convinced that was him, and this is what was going to happen. Is that the time now? Is that the time? This must be it. This must be the time. And typically, he doesn't answer them, typically. Instead, he reorients them, and says to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that God has fixed, but you'll receive power and understanding when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. In other words, stop thinking about your agenda, your assumptions. Understand, this is my agenda. This is God's agenda. And notice how opposed these two agendas are. They say to him things like, are you going to do this? And he'll say, you will do this. They're like, this must be what you're doing. Let me tell you what you're going to do. It's just always like that. Doesn't that pretty much sum up so much of how we relate to God? Like, Lord, surely, Lord, you're going to do such and such. You must want this. You must agree with me on this. And he says, I've already done everything. You witness to me, is what he says to us over and over. It's not about you and what you think ought to happen. It's about me and what I'm doing and have done and will do. You witness to me. And we say, well, yeah, I know, yeah, but we are supposed to, bring in the kingdom, God, right? We're supposed to spread the kingdom, right? You witness to me. I will bring in the kingdom. It's Jesus. It's not we who set the agenda for his church. And it's his power, not our power, that will fulfill that agenda. Much like these slightly confused early disciples, we in the church, and sometimes our leaders in the church, often assume that our priorities and methods must be God's as well. Aren't we doing it out of the right motives and everything? And we are convinced that advancing the kingdom means, you know, working for justice, doing good works, doing benevolent works, supporting good causes, doing this and that. And this is really the main business of the church. And personally witnessing, telling everyone about Jesus and who he is and what he did. And what he had to do because the sins of the world. Because sins had to be redeemed, the sins of the world. Personally witnessing to that is somehow pushed aside. See? Some might even feel it's a little pushy even to claim that Jesus is the unique and only Savior of the world. I encountered such a person this week in my studies, a scholar. I read some stuff he wrote and actually admired his honesty as he admitted that in 30 years of preaching, he had avoided talking about the ascension completely. Too otherworldly, he said. What am I supposed to do with this, he said, in today's kind of scientific, rational world? How do I really apply this to the here and now and the work of the church? I wonder what he does with all the other important events in Jesus' life. The incarnation itself, the resurrection, etc. It's a simple answer. What you do with it, you witness to it that it's true, that it's real, that it's happened, that it testifies of to who Jesus is, that he is the only name under heaven by which people are saved. He is the one who reveals the living God to the world. Witnessing to Jesus is declaring that the man, Jesus Christ, lived, died for our sins, rose again, and in that same glorified flesh now reigns over all creation from heaven. This proclamation, this gospel, is what advances the kingdom of God to the ends of the earth under the power of the Holy Spirit. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. So far from being this either-or thing, like you either witness to Jesus or work for justice, these things are not in opposition. They're two sides of the same coin, you see. And they are the mission of the church. You cannot have one without the other. We can only help bring in the kingdom in the power of the Spirit, and that is only done by witnessing to Christ in the power of the Spirit. Later, in the book of Acts, later, in chapter 17, Paul is out on his mission work, and he and his protege Silas are in Thessalonica, I believe it is, and they are surrounded by a very irate mob of Jews who are very upset at what they're teaching, and they are accusing them of everything under the earth, and they bring them to the magistrate there, and one of them, and they're all yelling out saying, these men have turned the world upside down with their teaching, Paul and Silas. They were closer to the truth than they realized, those guys. Because actually, what Paul and Silas were doing, what the gospel does, is it turns the world right side up. It takes human beings off of the throne where we try to put ourselves and puts God up on the throne where we belong, where he belongs. Turns it right side up. That's what the gospel does, and that's what advances the kingdom of God, proclaiming Christ as king. Advances the kingdom of God. So Ascension Day is not a day to sort of say, well, it's a nice story, but it's a day to affirm the ongoing work of Christ through his Spirit and to ask that Spirit to empower his church for witness and mission that the kingdom of God in all its glory may truly and fully come at last. And we need it now as much as ever, do we not? Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, there is so much going on, as you know well, in our lives that is occupying us and in some ways controlling us, restricting us, oppressing us, and we could call it some expression of the kingdoms of the world. Various powers, forces at work in the world, seen and unseen, that are exerting themselves in a way we have not seen before. During this time, Lord, we consistently have been turning to you for solace and comfort, and you have been faithful and have upheld us. Continue to do so, O Lord, as this time extends much further than any of us anticipated. It is testing us all, as 140 days is succeeded by another 40 days, and maybe yet another after that. In our own power, we can do so little, and only in the power of your Spirit can we endure. Renew in us, O Lord, a right spirit, and enable us to persevere through this thing and trust in you to bring us into glory at last. O God, our hearts are with all of our fellow residents who we know are struggling the way we are, and especially those who are confined in a particular way. We've had testing this week. We've had some positives, asymptomatic, but nonetheless, it's required another set of precautionary steps to be taken to the end of preserving the safety of our residents and staff. And so we pray for us to be able to endure through this successfully, and that those steps will be successful to contain this, that we may look forward to moving toward a relaxation of these restrictions on our lives and our freedom. Oh God, we want to thank you for our wonderful staff who are working so hard, sleepless, and in so many ways, more than can be said. Please uphold them, protect their health as well, and their family's health. We think of others who are in similar circumstances, communities like ours, throughout our company, ACTS, and other places like us, who are likewise going through the same things, and we join with them in communion of heart, calling out to you to preserve us and protect us and help us to endure. Enable us, Lord, to support each other through all of this. Lord, we pray for our leaders and those in authority over us who are making very profound decisions affecting everyone in the country. May they be operating with proper data and motives, and may you bless their efforts finally with success. Have mercy on us, O Lord, and hear us from your heavenly throne as we pray to you now, as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, so all these things we've referred to of Jesus' mission, ministry, and all these events in his life are, in fact, one great story, of course. There was a movie a long time ago, The Greatest Story Ever Told, and it's a pretty good title for what happened. And so let's sing and join together in the wonderful song. I'll give this a kind of a little country flavor. I Love to Tell the Story. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancies of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story. It did so much for me, and that is just the reason I tell it now to thee. I love to tell the story. Will be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story. 'Tis pleasant to repeat what seems each time I tell it more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story. Will be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, for those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new, new song, 'twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace now and forever. Amen. Have a good day, everyone.